Tonight, the Prime Minister confirms reports of a planned cabinet reshuffle. The Principals Association and the NYC are disgusted by a porn video featuring a minor as police launch an investigation into the viral video. A new book chronicling St. Lucia's presence at the UN is launched as part of Nobel Laureate Festival activities. And the Prime Minister says last weekend's Food and Rum Festival exceeded all expectations. Good evening to you. Welcome to the Monday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. Our top story. Prime Minister Alan Chastney has confirmed that there is a major cabinet reshuffle coming soon. The Prime Minister says he has been in dialogue with members on how the cabinet can be strengthened. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
The reshuffle is expected to see a number of ministries changing portfolios, and although he did not care to elaborate, sources have confirmed that the Ministry of the Public Service will be affected.
I will be making some announcements of some shifts that we're going to be doing, some alignments as we've gone by that we feel that will strengthen the performance of Cabinet, but hopefully I will never stop looking at how I can make things better.
Cabinet reshuffles happen in parliamentary systems for a variety of reasons. It is also a way for the Prime Minister to refresh the government, remove poor performers and reward supporters and punish others. However, Prime Minister Alan Chastney believes the reshuffle will not affect the image of the government.
If I'm going to do any shuffles, it's about improving the performance. And I don't think there's any wholesale changes in the cabinet we're looking at. We're looking at maybe some of the portfolios might be more suitable in other ministries. But in terms of saying that I'm changing any of my ministers, that's not what's in the plan. What we're doing is shifting some of the portfolios from one minister to another ministry because we think it might be better placed there. So we've tried something. If it doesn't work out, we're going to change it.
This will be the first since assuming office in June 2016. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The National Principals Association and the National Youth Council have expressed disgust with the latest in a string of pornographic videos featuring minors and being circulated on social media. In this latest video, the female subject appears to be coerced into performing sex acts on a male. This has prompted calls for the police to intervene and for charges to be pressed against the alleged aggressor.
The video shows a female student who is apparently being forced into performing oral sex on a young man who verbally and physically abuses her while being filmed by another individual.
The National Principals Association vehemently denounces all acts of abuse by minors, especially those perpetrated by principals like ourselves, teachers, members of the general public. We empathize with the young person in question, and our concern is obviously for her school and for her family. And an act like this, it brings to the fore the improper use of technology, and it also is in contravention with the rights of minors as identified by the Children's and Young Persons Act of 1997.
The National Youth Council has weighed in, condemning the act, which the organization says is a criminal offense.
The St. Lucia National Youth Council would like to commend the police for a prompt response into the investigation of the sexual video that has been released over the weekend. And it is our hope that justice will be served to all those who are in violation of any sections of the Computer Misuse Act and any other criminal offenses. The Youth Council is also very disappointed that young people continue to engage in such activities and recording, more or less, of such sexual acts. We would like to encourage our young ladies to be a little more vigilant in terms of not getting themselves into, you know, situations such as these. And we would also like to say to our young men that we need to have a little more respect for our sisters and our mothers and the women in society who are responsible for raising us and bringing us up, and let us be more, you know, better citizens in terms of how we treat women.
The National Principals Association says it will put measures in place to ensure that the student population of the school in question is not affected psychologically.
The staff of the school in question is very professional, and they have already put in strategies in place to deal with the general population. There has to be sensitivity towards that student when they return to school. And also, the programs will be put in place to ensure that that student and other students receive counseling, to ensure that when faced with similar situations, the same is not repeated. Additionally, this will begin the dialogue for all secondary schools on island, to ensure that the children are aware of their rights, their responsibilities, and it will empower them to speak up and against all acts of any abuse in general.
Police sources have disclosed that the matter is currently being investigated by officials attached to the Vulnerable Persons Unit, and the student is receiving counseling. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Meanwhile, Prime Minister Alan Chastney and Social Justice Minister Leonard Montout have expressed concern about the circulation of sexually explicit videos featuring minors on the internet. The Prime Minister spoke of devising new legislation to clamp down on such videos and to deal with the persons posting and circulating them. Here is Don Nicholas.
It appears that the participants in sexually explicit videos are getting younger. Prime Minister Alan Chastney has expressed concern about the trend, saying that government will be looking into devising new legislation to clamp down on the perpetrators.
It's even radio shows, TV shows. There is no code of conduct that we can legally hold people accountable to. And I've asked the Attorney General's office, along with the Ministry of Justice, to review those ASAP. And also now to amend our Broadcasting Act so we can take action against those people. It's
Social Justice Minister Leonard Motut also expressed similar concerns. He spoke about the introduction of more social programs to curb this immoral behavior.
There are a lot of social programs that exist and to come on stream that we are hoping that we will. I mean, it is difficult to police those things. I mean, parenting comes into play. Vigilance of citizens come into play. We're hoping that with the various programs that we're going to have, training programs, for example, that people are going to realize and recognize that, you know, those immoral acts should not be performed, and those crimes against children will diminish.
Mr. Motut is hoping that with such interventions, they will bring an end to the practice. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In other news, government is in the process of refining its economic development plans for the new year. Among them are plans to increase the economic benefits of tourism and improving the road network.
Prime Minister Alan Chastney did not want to say much about government's plans for the new year just yet. However, he did speak about the early completion of the budget, increasing economic benefits through tourism, and improving the road network as items on the agenda.
There are several new hotel projects coming on. There's major capital initiatives in terms of roads, facilities like the police headquarters, the new courthouses, the new airport terminals, new cruise ship terminals will all be spoken about.
Equity, Social Justice and Empowerment Minister Leonard Motut spoke about a number of projects in his constituency, namely the setting up of ICT centers and the construction of a children's park. The minister also spoke about upgrading bypass roads to facilitate the renovation of the Castries-Groseilliers Highway.
We want to, rather than just have the area grass, we want to provide a sand in that area so that you could have a playing area for children, you could have a volleyball court, for example, established, a beach volleyball court established, and along with the rides and the barbecue pits and so on, and the restaurant that will be established in that park area.
Minister Motut spoke just ahead of Monday's cabinet session. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Don Nicholas, and this is Street Vibes. The topic for today: should children under 12 be allowed to use the social media?
No. Okay, they're not supposed. Well, because some of them does do wrong things, they just go bad and do all that stuff.
No.
Why you say no?
Well, for me, they're underage. No, they're underage. You're not supposed to use that. That's the way I see it.
I don't think children under 12 should be using social media because too much things are going on the internet, sexual activities, all kind of stuff is not good. And they learn all different things and we out the parents thinking like, where our children learn that, but it's social media.
I think they should, you know, under the supervision of an adult, okay, because we as adults, we never know what our children can do, you know. If we don't monitor our children's Facebook or social media profile, we may never know. Probably we can only hear from other people out there. You know, so I think they should, under the supervision of their parents.
This has been Street Vibes with me, Don Nicholas. We now take you back to the studio.
You're watching St. Lucia's Television and News Leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and the big screen at the Quirias Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, the Prime Minister says last weekend's Food and Rum Festival exceeded expectations and Walcott House reopens its doors. Thank you so much for staying on the broadcast. A press launch for a coffee table book chronicling St. Lucia's presence within the United Nations since attaining independence took place at the Financial Building at Point Surfing today. The publication is entitled St. Lucia, The United Nations Journey 1979 to 2016 and has been produced as a gift to the nation by St. Lucia's former ambassador to the UN, Miss Minnie Sarambali. We hear more in this report.
Monday's book launch brought together a number of local dignitaries, including former Governor General Dame Paulette Louisi, who is also the chairperson of the Nobel Laureate Festival Committee. The launch was included on the list of Nobel Laureate Festival activities. For Senator Adrian Ogier, who hosted the event, the inclusion was quite appropriate, as like many of the activities making up the Nobel Laureate calendar, it celebrates the uniqueness of the island, its citizens, and their local, regional, and international achievements.
This country, which has played such a distinctive role in global politics, in economics for many, many centuries, and whose impact on the world, I think, and global affairs we often underestimate. We have been leaders in many respects of history, geography, politics, economics, and sometimes we forget that. And I think today, and the publication we are marking, celebrates the role, the amazing role of this little amazing country and the things that we have managed to achieve on the global stage.
The book is authored by Manisa Rambali, who represented the Castries Southeast constituency on a St. Lucia Labour Party ticket. She was appointed permanent representative for St. Lucia to the United Nations in 2012. It is while serving in that capacity that she got inspired to put the book together.
I was immediately struck by the great illustrations of service of those who came before me. Our reputation had been set on a trajectory that made me proud as a young St. Lucian. But more so, that reputation inspired and encouraged me to maintain the standards that had been set by my predecessors.
She describes the publication as a gift to the country, one that pays homage to her predecessors at the UN through a collection of photographs and quotations from these very distinguished St. Lucians who left their mark at the UN and, by extension, on the world stage.
This represents who we have shown ourselves to the world to be. Our capacity reveals that when we put St. Lucia first, much can be achieved.
Ms. Rambali hopes that the book will serve as a reminder that at least in this case, size doesn't matter and that St. Lucia's smallness is no reflection of the magnitude of its contribution to the global body. The book, which is a limited print edition, will be shared with those featured in the publication, the National Archives, Central Library, the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College, and other organizations which serve as repositories of historical information on the island. There are plans to make electronic versions of the book available on the island's UN Permanent Mission website. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The St. Lucia National Trust has reopened the doors of the Walcott House on Chaussee Road. A few sketches by Sir Derek Walcott portraying plays which he did in 1996 are on display. Walcott Place is supposed to create a physical space to celebrate Roderick and Derek Walcott's achievements and to be a source of inspiration and education. It is expected to be the focal point for the acknowledgement of the enormity of their contribution to the arts. The Walcott Place project restored the Walcott's childhood home at Grass Street. The home was closed temporarily following government's decision to cut its subvention to the trust.
Historically, it wasn't a very successful play, but still, it just having that those watercolors show a sort of a thought process that Sir Derek would have engaged in to create these plays and also to write his scripts. So we're very excited about that, and we've also got some work from Cedric George and Niger Nestor that we're displaying upstairs.
The Walcott House will be open Monday to Friday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Prime Minister Alan Shastin says the Food and Rum Festival exceeded all expectations. The festival started with a massive crowd showing up for the Ansari Fish Friday and ended on Sunday with a performance by local entertainer Teddy St. John. On Saturday, internationally renowned chef Marcus Samuelson, with the assistance of local chefs, recreated his 2009 state dinner for then U.S. President Barack Obama, but this time with a St. Lucian twist.
By all accounts, the Food and Rum Festival got off to a good start. There was a massive crowd that turned up at the revamped Ansari Fish Friday event. Headliner Burning Flames out of Antigua performed there. This has prompted Prime Minister Alan Shastin to call on restaurants to hold a monthly food and rum event.
But if you take what took place in Ansari, where you had thousands of people and that the businesses in Ansari benefited. So I think that the Rodney Bay event as well, when they spoke to the restaurateurs and the people of bars, that they felt that economic impact of the event. So the goal here is to get the restaurants who want to participate in food and rum moving forward to put on a food and rum event once a month.
On Saturday, the action continued at the Rodney Bay Village with a celebrity chef's dinner at the Cocoa Resorts featuring internationally renowned chef Marcus Samuelson. With the assistance of local chefs, he recreated his 2009 state dinner for then U.S. President Barack Obama, but this time with a St. Lucian twist. The grand finale took place on Sunday at the Pigeon Island National Landmark, where local entertainer Teddy St. John brought down the curtains on the festival.
It's service and servitude if, in fact, the staff don't add value. So the ability to add value is understanding the cuisine and the presentation to the guest. And it's the pairing. How do you pair rums with the different foods and become experts ourselves?
The event culminated with the inaugural Caribbean Rum Awards. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The Caribbean Community CARICOM said it is deeply disturbed by reports about the use of derogatory and repulsive language by the President of the United States in relation to CARICOM member state Haiti and other developing countries. Last week, U.S. President Donald Trump used derogatory language to refer to Haiti and Africa during an immigration meeting with members of Congress. He added that America should be bringing in more people from countries like Norway. CARICOM condemns in the strongest terms the unenlightened views reportedly expressed, the regional bloc said in a statement. Of additional concern to CARICOM is this pattern of denigrating Haiti and its citizens in what seems to be a concerted attempt to perpetuate a negative narrative of the country. CARICOM expressed its full support for the dignified statement of the government of Haiti in reaction to this highly offensive reference, recalling that Haiti is the second democracy in the Western Hemisphere after the United States and that Haitians continue to contribute significantly in many spheres to the global community and particularly to the United States. When we come back in just a moment, preparing local youth to take advantage of online job opportunities. Welcome back to the broadcast. The Gama Learning Institute is working with regional and international counterparts to build a network of technology clubs throughout the Caribbean. The aim is to enable young persons to work for international organizations from home. Don Nicholas has the details.
RSC International is a non-profit organization set up to effect change in the Caribbean through the infusion of technology. To this end, the organization has set up a number of technology clubs throughout the region and is in the process of starting one in St. Lucia. This will be done in partnership with the Caribbean Association of Principals of Secondary Schools and International Business Machines Corporation, which will contribute the expertise to train young people. Monday, a workshop on Internet of Things was held. The objective is to have students within the Caribbean working with each other so that the Caribbean could become a provider of technology services. This will allow students to work for international organizations from the comfort of their homes.
We're looking at combining and getting job access from outsourcing so students can stay at home and work for organizations in India, the USA, Europe, and so on.
The Gama Learning Institute is coordinating the activity.
We at Gama are coordinating all the St. Lucian programs that RSC will be hosting.
Gama Learning Institute has partnered with the IBM International on the initiative.
What we're realizing is that there's this new generation that's coming up. And while we tend to work a lot with the enterprises throughout the region, the banks and the governments, etc., there wasn't as much of a focus on the younger generation. So fortunately, I got this job, and my role is really to try and see how we can, you know, get to these people, get to the startups, get to the young people, and introduce them to the technology.
Monday's workshop took place at the National Skills Development Center. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Lewis Industries Limited has come to the aid of the St. Lucia Blind Welfare Association. The SLBWA has been struggling financially and faced closure as a result. Since then, several local businesses have come forward to assist.
The organization in recent times has been struggling to keep its doors open. Last year, former Governor General Her Excellency Dame Paulette Louisi launched an appeal for urgent assistance and support for the SLBWA by members of the public. That appeal did not fall on deaf ears.
I do not believe as a society we do enough to help our local community domestically, and you are right. There is a disaster in another country, everybody would go helter-skelter and they would give assistance, but right here in St. Lucia they wouldn't. And we believe, whilst Lewis Industries Limited cannot change the mindset of the general populace, we believe as an organization, in one small way, we can make a difference. And that's why we're starting today with the Blind Welfare Association as part of our New Year's gift. And it's something that we will continue to do, and we will motivate other organizations to follow suit. Some of them have, kudos to them. But some of them do not, and I'm hoping that they can in some small way make a difference, because if one person takes a step, they will get to that journey, of that destination.
At a brief ceremony on Monday, the company presented a check of $1,000 to the association. The sum is said to be the first of a series of payments which will be made throughout the year.
We believe that the business community should help other corporate citizens, and especially the Blind Welfare Association. Whilst I believe that government should not renege from their responsibility of these social factors, I also believe that the business community can assist, because with our assistance we can make a difference no matter how small it is. So we made a decision at Lewis Industries that we will support the Blind Welfare Association on a yearly basis, and we will do it more than once a year.
The executive director of the organization expressed gratitude for the donation, noting that it will help keep the association doors open.
St. Lucia Blind Welfare Association is serving the country. It is not there because of one person, not because of Anthony Avril, but it is there because in St. Lucia, we have a great need for a dynamic organization like the St. Lucia Blind Welfare Association. Significant numbers of our population are affected. They have their vision affected. I'm talking about their physical vision. There was a time when it was generally believed that blindness was only the purview of the older people. But we have found since the 80s, when we established our Kiss Find programs into the schools and community system, that vision impairment is huge among the all segments of the society. And that is why you find that we make such an effort to try to capture the problem early, particularly as it relates to children, to allow us the possibility of intervening in order to arrest the further deterioration of their sight and to give them a chance to follow their various education paths.
The handing over took place Monday morning at the St. Lucia Blind Welfare Headquarters. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues. Finally from us, on the lighter side. A group of university students in Mexico used recycled materials to create a can-crushing machine to reduce waste. The students at Pan American University in Mexico said they used mostly recycled materials to build a small machine which manipulates a piece of wood to crush cans one by one. One of the students shared a video of the machine in action on Twitter. The student said the machine was designed to reduce waste by compressing the discarded cans. Quite an innovative gesture. And now, the usual reminder. Tonight, the Prime Minister confirms reports of a planned cabinet reshuffle. The Principals Association and the NYC are disgusted by a porn video featuring a minor as police launch an investigation into the viral video. A new book chronicling St. Lucia's presence at the UN is launched as part of Nobel Laureate Festival activities. And the Prime Minister says last weekend's Food and Rum Festival exceeded all expectations. That's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polion, wishing you a very good evening and reminding you that the 2018 season of talk shows right here on DBS commences this evening from 8:30. Join Kenson Casimir for 758 Sports Talk. Good night.